How we doing, cameraman? Are we on?
We be on.
Alright, we be on. Alright, folks, back for another live session. Hope you missed me, well, at least with every dart or bullet so far. I guess you did. So we're back live, got a few things for you. Obviously, Super Bowl Sunday turned out in my favor. So, way to go, Pats. Way to go, Tom Brady. Greatest of all time. So as I'm waiting for people to sign in and stuff, I'm just going to kill some time. Speaking of Super Bowl Sunday, if you tuned in early at my time, you watched me try to devour a carrot cake made for me by my protege, Andy Sinclair, that had Go Pats Super Bowl 51 on it. You can go through the archives if you want to see that. And I did quite a dent on that for refeed day. But speaking of refeed day, I got to tell you, supermodel, super fitness model Andy Sinclair, the boy can eat. So when he got over here to watch Super Bowl with me, abs and all these funny questions we get about him cutting his water for these live sessions and cutting his carbs. We ordered two mutant pizzas and something called a box of chicken wings. And it was a box of chicken wings. And yeah, I had to bow out and take the old man senior category earlier in the chow down. And Andy made me proud and reminded me of my old refeed days and scarfed down most of two pizzas. And I resorted to going to the barley malts myself. But that was something. And then, of course, before Andy left, he polished off the carrot cake of his own making. So it was quite a scene to watch. Cycle diet rules. Gotta love the way you can fit diet strategy into living in the real world and celebrating things like holidays and Christmas and things like Super Bowl as well. So how are we doing for people coming on board there?
Getting better all the time.
Yeah, we got more than five?
Oh, yeah.
All right. So, all right, folks, we're going to get to it. We've had a few questions. And no, I'm not here alone. You guys don't want to look at my mug all the time. So I'm going to bring my buddy, my protege in, Andy Sinclair. All right. So we got a few things we're up to today. We had a question after. I guess a lot of people are shy to write in, actually, on Facebook Live. So I had a question. Can we show certain exercises? Of course we can. We're also going to add a few things. We're here every Thursday working on Andy's abs, rock hard abs, Andy's awesome rock hard abs training circuits that will be coming out soon. And I get excited just doing every Thursday we get in here, and I just can't control myself. It's so exciting to watch. So, but we had some questions. Can we show some straight arm pull downs? So we'll start with some exercise demos, and then we'll take a few even from Andy's upcoming project to show you the kind of thing we're getting into. And you wanted to do a shout out to a country in particular?
Oh, yeah. G'day, mate. Australia.
All right. Shout out to Australia, where there's some buzz about maybe us coming down under sometime in the future. But we leave that in the hands of people who can arrange those things. So if there's interest in us having us there, well, I know there's interest in having him there, let us know and look into it. Anyway, we're going to start out. The question was, could we show proper form for straight arm pull downs? Very, very effective lat exercise, very underutilized, because you can't use a lot of weight with it. It's one of those exercises that keeps you very honest. But I also want to show you a variant of that that turns it into a functional training exercise, and that's called swimmers. And a lot of the times what we'll do is we'll superset both in one of my programs. So first we'll just demonstrate proper form for the straight arm pull downs. Wait till you see the muscles in his back dancing. I just grin every time I see it. So we rehearsed this before we got on here. And then Andy's going to show you the swimmer combination. And we may even go back and forth. I don't want to exhaust the lad while he's here. Because we've been shooting for a while now. So, but we will show you some of the stuff we have in the hopper. And if there's any questions, by all means, write them in. And we'll take it from there. So first of all, Andy, show them a straight arm pull down. So he's going to get a nice, just wider than shoulder width grip. I like a thumbs over grip. It doesn't really matter if you do or you don't. So he stands away from the machine and he reaches just above head level. Anywhere from eye level to head level is fine. You see the lats working. You see the Christmas tree working. You stand up nice and straight. Boom. Boom. So that's, you want to come to the side there, cameraman, so they can see it from the side. You can rush over. Don't worry about balance. So just keep going, Andy, so we can get that from the shoulders and tricep and back. Bring it right into your thighs. Boom. All right, good, good, good. Don't knock yourself out. So, any thoughts you want to share about the straight arm?
Personally, for me, I prefer to do them kneeling down, just because being taller, I get a way better range of motion. So,
that's some of the gyms with your long length, you probably end up crashing.
Yeah, like you can't get that full stretch, and it's just
All right, show them from the knees. And again, cameraman, you want to start there and then swoop your way down here. I'll get out of the way. So actually, this is way more effective now that I see it. Look at the way his muscles are working. That's it. Now, he's adding a bit of a crunch there. That's the way he likes to do it. If you see coming in, you see how ripped he is. All year long, folks. That's what a fitness model, that's how you get the gigs. You come in and you'll see the cross striations in his triceps and whatnot. Good. Good. I like that idea. Doing it from the knees. And if you've been following me for a while, everyone knows I love to do cable crossovers from the knees. So, that's a smart idea.
I just want to get more out of it. So.
Yeah, I never thought of that. Of course, with the functional trainer, you can adjust. See, that height is too high for me to do them. So I usually come down a notch and do them from a notch lower. So that's a good thing. So we'll get a question in there in a minute. If there are any. Are there any?
No.
Okay, no questions. So now we're going to switch to what we call swimmers. Now this is a little low of an angle for Andy, so he has to come out more, even though it's high enough for me. So a swimmer is more of a functional movement, and you'll see it's a lot like the straight arm pull-downs, but he's going to come right past his body, and the difference is that you get complete hip flexion. So instead of locking to isolate the lats, he's actually bending with the hips. Right, swimmers like to use this, that's why it's called swimmers. But it's still effective all through the back. And then he gets a squat motion and a bend motion. So you get the best of both worlds. And obviously you're doing this for speed and power. So whereas the straight arm pull down would be to isolate the lats with resistance, okay, the swimmer version is all about force over time, which is the definition of power. So it's about how fast you can do that with resistance. The cables don't lend to that at all. So the cables don't lend to that. What lends to that is using something like tubing, where you can really get on it and get after it and riff on it. So that's a real important thing as well. So those are the swimmers, and those are the straight arm pull downs. And to turn it into a monster, you do a superset of them. And that often works really, really well too. So as long as you have the right strength of bands, so you're not going to snap them or anything like that. Any thoughts on that, Andy?
Very metabolic. Obviously the swimmers, adding that in as part of the circuit. It's killer. You're going to fry everything back there and then get the conditioning demands as well. So
yeah, there's lots of ways to work muscles. That's part of what Andy's ab score thing is about, is that just adding resistance all the time, like, oh, I got to lift more weight. Well, sometimes adding motion is increase of a degree of difficulty as well, and things like that. So you have to pay attention to those kind of things. So how are we doing there with our audience?
We're gaining people all the time.
All right. Any questions out there?
No.
Folks?
No.
No questions. Any comments?
Well, the Aussies are back, I see.
Oh, okay. All right. Any other countries?
They haven't identified themselves.
Okay. Well, I'm sure they will. So what do you think, Andy? We should show them some... Well, wait a minute. I gotta give you a rest. You've been shooting exercises for a while. So before we engage in more exercise, I get a couple typical questions of the industry. So I'm not surprised we've got them. But a couple questions for Andy, of course. Well, no, I don't want to move back. I want to do this. So cameraman's starting to be like a director. He's getting a little feisty with us. So I got a couple questions, and I'm not surprised we get these kind of questions all the time. So someone was asking, of course, Andy, the bench press. How much do you bench press?
I don't even remember the last time I did a flat barbell bench press, actually.
So. And why is that?
I'm not very well suited for the exercise. I mean, I got these long arms, long torso. It's not a good exercise for
me. And who writes your programs?
Scott Abel.
So I don't have Andy doing any bench press.
Here's a question for you, and I don't even know what a face pull is, but somebody
face
wants
pulls?
Face pull.
We'll get to him. it's a It's a sexy exercise that doesn't have a whole lot of relevance, but we'll demo them if you want to see them. I'm getting back to the bench press because it's important. You see someone with really long limbs like Andy, if I had him bench pressing, all that would do is increase his risk of injury while adding nothing to solid chest development, whereas the dumbbells are the King Kong exercise for that. So the answer, even in my prime, when I was all buff, and stuff like that, the answer to how much do I bench is I don't. I didn't bench for a lot of years, and I was known for pretty solid upper body development. So, again, one of those typical questions that the nature of the question illustrates someone's level of understanding and that they actually need to be redirected to understanding something actually a little better. There are no magic exercises, and the bench press is probably the most overrated exercise there is if your goal is physique development. Yeah. You're a power lifter, then fine, go get it. But if you're after physique development, then the bench, I wouldn't even rate in the top five exercises. So the other one, obviously, as you were turning in, I was just sort of anecdoting you guys about Super Bowl meals and whatnot and Andy's capacity to eat, which is, I was impressed, and I don't impress easy when it comes to refeeds. So again, the other question, I know we've covered it, but again, the question is, how much cardio does Andy do? Take it away.
Zero. I haven't done any steady state, treadmill or stationary bike in probably over a decade now. But the only thing closest to cardio I get is walking my dog, probably. So.
And the results of this are... what produces this results are twofold, folks. Proper programming and a long-term sustainable diet strategy. To look this way all year long rather than looking this way for a couple weeks because you're competing or you're doing this or you're doing that. Why waste that energy? So that's the beauty of the cycle diet, and that's the testament to proper programming for somebody.
So. And it really makes your body more fuel efficient over time, too. So if you think about what that means, if you have a more fuel-efficient car, you're getting more miles per gallon, right? So basically, over time, you're training your body to be more efficient at using fat for energy. So that's not a good thing. You're turning your metabolism...
Well, for cardio, you mean.
For aerobic cardio.
Yeah, I'll get into the aerobic myth probably another time, unless people want to talk about it now. But you're literally spinning your wheels if you're thinking that doing extended amounts of cardio...
Not to mention it's boring as hell, too. Right?
Well, some people don't find it boring. I mean, for some people, it gets their endorphins up and more power to you, but it's not going to sculpt your physique or make you look lean and chiseled. That's not what aerobic activity is ever going to do, and that's a story for another time. So, so those were two questions that came in about Andy, and just thought we'd nip those in the bud real quick. Any questions out there? Is everybody being
excited? they're perking up.
Okay.
If possible, could the swimmer's pull down be done slowly? I'm trying to see what muscles should be working.
No. And, you mean
and demoed, what is the correct movement?
Demoed slowly? They want to see it demoed slowly?
No.
No, okay. Can it be done slowly? No, because if you're going to do it slowly, then you're doing a straight... then you're doing a straight arm pull down, and you're not going to want to bend at the waist with that because you increase risk of injury to your lower back. Swimmer exercise is meant for function. It's meant for power. Power is strength expressed with velocity, right? So that's a very, very important element. So no, it shouldn't ever be done slowly. Otherwise, it's no longer a swimmer. It's not really anything in that regard. So, although you could do the upper half of the straight arm pull down with tubing for speed. That would be possible, but it would still be sort of a modified swimmer at that point. That's a good question, actually.
Hey, Scott, or Andy, what is the best exercise for getting a six-pack to look bigger and thicker?
That's
what we're working on. we have a project coming out that's all about that.
Yeah, stay tuned for that. Listen,
there are no magic exercises. There's no magic exercises. The number one principle that you got to get through your head is that there are no magic exercises. And the number two principle is to go back and visit principle number one.
Yeah.
All right. The idea is the brilliance, the sophistication. We've been talking about this for an hour before we came live with Andy's project, is the sophistication and the brilliance is in exercise sequencing. How exercises are put together is what is an illustration of both expertise and progress and actually achievement. So it's not about a magic exercise. It's where that exercise fits in the overall program. But there are some pretty special ones we can use. As you can see, Andy's got really well-developed abs. There's no question. Intercostals, serratus. Wait till you see the project that's coming out. I mean, holy crap, even I have to pause and just sort of, instead of talking about the demo, I just sort of pause and watch myself, because it's pretty impressive to see a chiseled physique in action. But anyway, I'll let you take some thoughts on that, exercise. Maybe talk about your favorite ones.
Applications, everything. So yeah, there are no magic exercises. So my favorite ab exercise is probably anything that requires like a pre-stretch above your head. So stability ball sit-ups with the medicine ball overhead, stability ball exchanges, pike-ups.
Let's show them that one, because we used it in the project. I'll show them in a second. But he just gave away a juicy nugget, folks, because I think a lot of people who are trying to get solid abs or lean in that area, they don't ever think about hands overhead as a starting position. And if let's put your hands over your head and lock it up. As you can see, when Andy does that and even puts them behind, he's got engagement already in the serratus. Mm-hmm. And then when he continues to focus and make it more ab-centric, then all that's going to contribute to the contraction. So we'll take something normal, like a sit-up, and something normal, like a crunch, and we'll combine them together. Right? You said stability ball sit-up?
With the medicine ball.
With the medicine ball? So this is where expertise comes into play. When is a sit-up not a sit-up? When is a crunch not a crunch? How do you understand kinetic chain function? These are the things that illustrate expertise. They're not just random exercises. So you'll see what Andy said, and it's clear in your circuit training program. Wait till it comes out, folks. It's pretty freaking awesome. What you'll see is Andy chose a lot of exercises that deliberately begin in two of his favorite things. One, hands over his head, like he just explained to you, and or exercises from the plank. Which is also brilliant. One of the most effective ways to engage the abs core. So show them what you had in mind. So this is a stability ball sit-up with a medicine ball. So it's a full, what we call a full sit-up. But look what he's doing. Starts with the hands way overhead, and instead of just crunching, he comes all the way up, touches the ball to the floor. It's a touch-and-go exercise. Notice he's not trying to generate velocity and using momentum. And he thinks back here. On his way up, he thinks crunch, and then he thinks flex. And the other thing, if you think in terms of body part exercises, in this position, it's a lot like a dumbbell pullover. But then what happens? What in a dumbbell pullover, the reason we do that in bodybuilding, engages the lats. Go ahead, do another one. And then engages the serratus. And then as he comes up, finish, you get the intercostals as well. So really, really, really brilliant use of kinetic chain movements and understanding how muscles work both with isolation intent and overall. So that's a real important thing. Why don't we show them a couple other ones from the project?
Yeah, let's do it.
We'll do...
Could I interrupt just for a second, Scott?
No.
I screwed up on this. What the hell are we looking at here?
Comments?
On the comments, but they wanted that exercise, the swimmer, done demoed slowly, so that they
it's
could.
It's hard to demo slowly.
Okay.
Go ahead, Andy.
Trying.
We can slow it down, but it can't be done slowly. So what you want to do, you want to get up to a position where the cables are pulling you forward. That's your start position, because that's what engages the muscles. Muscles stretch with resistance, receive the most overload, right? And then he's going to come down. Right, he's going to come all the way down, he bends with it, and he takes it past his body point, which you can't do with the straight arm pull downs, and then a little faster this time, Andy. He comes up with it, and you see that, boom, you see that, boom. It's not even a pull down anymore, right? You see, folks, when we talk about functional training, yeah, just do a few more. we talk about the alphabet of training. We talk about the ground, we talk about gravity, and we talk about the body. So as we see here, we say power starts from the ground, but is driven through the core. Right? So that's one of those things. Good, good. Does that suffice, folks?
Whoops.
That's okay. No, don't worry about
banging this thing around here.
Don't worry about shake and bake, my friend.
Yes, it does.
All right, so Andy surprised me with this.
Deborah says she's got it.
She's got it. All right.
All right, there you go.
Usually when I say I got it, other people say, I hope it's not spreading. So, what do you get from a man who has everything? Penicillin. Okay. So now we're going to do, Andy's going to show you a variation. This is in his ab circuit, but we're going to show you how to dial it up, dial it down. So one of the things a lot of people you'll see in the gym, very popular movement from the plank, is the alternating plank pull-in. Tell them what they're doing wrong, you know, most of the time.
Basically, the dumbbells are usually too far underneath them. They want to be in front of you a little bit more, because that's going to engage your core a lot more. So
let's show them first the proper starting position. Because here again, folks, it's not about weight. You don't want big gut, big abs. So when Andy gets into the plank here, now before you even start, most people start with these weights under their shoulders, right? Because your body wants to make everything easier. If you're doing a plank pull-in and you want maximum lower ab recruitment, move them out a bit, then the farther that weight is in front of you, the harder it's going to be. All right? And then you're going to feel this through your whole body. So just do a few, show them how it is. And most of you have seen this. You've just never seen them done right. So again, the further that is in front of you, the harder it's going to be. You want to make it easier, now bring them in for two. Boom. Okay. All right. Stop. Now you've all seen that. And then now for this variation, cameraman, you're going to want to get in and get front, side, back, and all that stuff. Now I know you said before you like that because you feel it anterior and posterior, correct?
Yeah.
That's something a little bit about, you know, the glutes and the rest of it.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it requires huge glute activation too to hold yourself in a plank position like that.
Especially while moving.
Yeah. While pulling a dumbbell. Into you. So, I mean, you can feel it through your whole core, stabilizing everything. And we can even up the intensity a little bit by adding another little tweak to it.
Now, so. Most of you, here's what 90% of personal trainers in the gym won't get. What do they think? Progressive resistance. Automatically, people think progressive resistance means progressive load. How are you going to make this exercise harder? Oh, I got to make the weight heavier. No. Not if it sacrifices what the reason you're doing it, which is to engage lower abs and core. So you're going to have those weights. Remember, the start position, proper start position is that weight has to be in front of shoulder width. All right? Inside it, all right, is a digression, not a progression. All right? Now, watch how Andy turns alternating plank pull-ins into a monster. I freaking love this. Watch this. And you come in and get his back and his side, cameraman. So he gets in the position. All right. He's going to do the alternate come over.
Yeah, I'm coming.
Boom. All right. And then he goes, boom, with the T-stab. Boom. And then boom with the T-stab. Bam. Gets that full rotation. Boom. Look at the back muscles, folks, and the shoulder muscles and the triceps. Boom. Look at the triceps at the bottom. And then he rotates. Boom. Look at that full rotation. Do another one. Watch this. Look at the back muscles and everything happening, folks. Even the glutes are rotating. Wonderful. Bam. And then a full T-stab. Boom. Look at that rotation through the abs. Boom. So, how do you make an exercise harder? You can add movement, right? What you said from the beginning, the reason you could feel your glutes in the plank position, whereas most people can't, is because you added motion. So what did we do? We took that added motion to an extreme. We monsterfied it, right? So you turned it into a monster, and that was all Andy. I never thought of that one before, at least I don't think I did. I'm starting to get long-term loss of short-term memory at my age. But see how we turned that alternating plank pull-in into a monster. And the only way to make that even a further monster would be to do that T-stab with the dumbbell. But you could see everything working, both in the anterior chain and in the posterior chain in his back. So pretty freaking awesome. There's got to be a comment on that somewhere, or I got the wrong audience. Anything there, Brian?
Well, I'm
you're going to set it back so
I
got to
set
comments?
It down so I can read the comments. How about that?
All right. We're getting hard on our cameraman, folks. Let's do those layovers we talked about.
Yeah.
Go ahead, cameraman. Anything?
Well, Jen would like to know, you've mentioned it a few times in the past. She's talking about form, and is that the key to being successful?
Oh, in my book, yeah. I mean, there's, well, no, I wouldn't say form is the key to being successful. I would say applicable knowledge is the key to being successful, but most people don't have that. And right now what we have is a certification dilemma. You've heard me say how many times certified doesn't mean qualified. And that's because what the certification places want to do is they want to dumb down what it takes to be certified because they want the money for people to sign up to be certified. So anything that you can get certified in a weekend isn't a piece of paper worth having. Yeah. So, you know, I've been doing this 4.5 decades to be an expert. And usually that's the kind of thing that expertise requires. So form is important, don't get me wrong. Not only the genetic elite will get by with doing everything wrong and still getting results. But let's not focus on the genetic elite. Let's focus on the genetically average. And, you know, you can check out Andy's before pictures, how he looked 13 years ago, to see what was under all that. Now, so, you got another question?
Heather would like to know if we could get that ball out again and properly show how you do the stability ball bridge with leg curls.
Yeah, we'll do that in a minute. We want to show you some ones from the actual project, you get in the position. We're just going to do some lying leg overs. Things sometimes, folks, simple is the most effective. So get in the position, Andy. So we're just going to do a lying leg over, and it's a touch and go, heels to the ground. The good thing about this, folks, is it begins with an anterior chain expression with the anterior obliques, but it requires tremendous, actually, glute work to go from side to side that way in a lateral chain. As he goes into the crucifix position, it makes the exercise even harder, right? Now, it's a touch and go, you're never bouncing, so just hold on to that for a second, Andy. Now, if I wanted to dial that up a notch, I'm going to do what?
We're going to put a dumbbell down so I have to raise my legs higher.
We're going
to
increase range of motion. Plain and simple. Same thing we're doing in the glute project. So we're going to, that's a medicine ball. Right, so now I'm just going to bring over a heavy dumbbell. All right, so now it's just a few inches higher. Boom, he goes over. Boom. Very, very effective. Boom. Just a lying leg over. In the crucifix position makes it a lot harder. Beautiful. Awesome. All right. So sometimes the simplest things can become the most effective things. So that's very, very important as well. So you're getting a lot of good free advice here, folks, but it should point out to the importance of real expertise in exercise sequencing, exercise programming. Like I always say, a collection of workouts is not a program, and a collection of exercises is not a workout. Not when it comes to effectiveness, and the answer to that question, what's the most important? And the most important is applied knowledge. So that was one we were going to show them. Why don't we show them the question that Heather had? We'll show them the leg curls with the hip bridge.
Yep.
And then we'll do the supine stay holds.
Let's do it.
All right. And then, folks, we're going to go soon. So if you have questions, file when ready. So you'll want to shoot this from different angles, cameraman. Maybe you could just swing around here, Andy, and do them sideways.
Yeah, sure.
So, yeah. The important thing here is to just dig your heels into the ball and get as much hip extension as you can in the start position. So you're going to get that glute bridge slash hip extension. So he's going to dig his heels into the ball. He probably hasn't done these in a while. And then he's going to up as high as he can and then curl right in. Boom. And as you curl in, you can definitely try to keep, yep, get those hips even higher. Bam. 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 Yep. And if you want to turn this into a monster, so that's all. Just keep the hips off the floor, but make sure you glute bridge when you start. Yep, no, I'm hopping you up.
Okay.
that should be enough unless someone didn't get out of that. Now, if you want to turn that into a monster, I would suggest doing it from the TRX because you can really dig your heels into the stirrups and get a pretty freaky range of motion doing that as well. So that's another pretty incredible option. So you want to show them some stay holds. Is there any burdening questions? No? Oh. The excitement of us being live has worn off, Andy.
Hey, Andy. Do you do a lot of vertical pull-type movements for lat development, like pull chin-ups?
Not a whole lot of chin-ups, no. Mainly rows. Rows are probably, in all their variations, are probably the best exercise to base your back workouts around. But I find chin-ups, like, they put a lot of stress on your biceps and the tendon, more so, like, I mean, there's a lot of people that can't do proper chin-ups, unless you use like an assisted chin-up machine. I mean, that's a good option, but chin-ups are a pretty difficult exercise.
For someone like Andy with really long limbs, not a good idea, right? So I wouldn't put him in many of Andy's programs unless they were assisted chin-up machine. He's got way too long of limbs. It's going to produce tremendous strain, unnecessary strain on the bicep tendon, as Andy said, and on the overall shoulder capsule. I know for some reason in the fitness industry, not necessarily the bodybuilding industry, chins is some magical thing, but really it's just another exercise that a lot of people aren't suited to do. And speaking of exercises a lot of people aren't suited to do, running and jogging. The most hurt people that end up in hospital rooms and physio folks are people who are joggers. Right, what we call sloggers, right?
Yeah.
Slow joggers. So the absolute worst thing you can do as an activity is running and jogging. There's only a few people whose bodies are built for that. It's terrible for hip alignment and wreaks havoc on the knees. Or you can reverse those. It wreaks havoc on hip alignment and terrible for the knees. Yeah. But someone like Andy, again, no cardio, blah, blah, blah. What were we going to show them? I lost my train of thought. Supine stay holds.
Yeah.
This one's tough, folks, but you'll notice it's like Andy said earlier. He's going to do it with that hands overhead option. Maybe we'll do it from the side as well, Andy. I'd like that because the cameraman...
Oh, this way, okay.
Yeah, the cameraman won't have to move as much.
Sure.
So.
Excellent.
Yeah. So Andy's going to start with his butt slash back. A lot of the times what's great for abs isn't so much things that require motion but stabilization. So he's going to, wait a minute, just before you start. Come on over here, cameraman, and just get him in the start position so people can actually get a shot at his abs.
Here, I was reading some comments here.
Just kneeling on your, so you can get him in the, and then maybe your triceps down there on the floor before, there you go, before he gets into the position.
How about that for a picture?
Yeah, there you go. All right. So he gets down in the right position. Notice there's his favorite position again that we mentioned that you're not going to see from people. Now, he's going to then raise his legs when he can. He's going to readjust. You got to adjust yourself on this, but there he goes. So now he's got nothing touching the ground. Heels are in the air. Arms are in the air. He's going to try to raise that body a little bit without losing his position. He's going to do a slow 20 count. And believe me, folks, this is a monster. So sometimes what doesn't look like effectiveness is this is probably the monster ab exercise, a stabilization supine hold, wicked, wicked through the abs. And again, what Andy said earlier that goes unnoticed by most people is engagement of the serratus and intercostals by one simple motion, and that's hands over head to begin. So tell them how hard that is.
Oh, that's wicked hard. I mean, for something where you're just trying to hold yourself stable, the oxygen that it produces too. So, I mean, you feel it everywhere, your glutes, your obliques, your serratus from keeping your arms stretched out, upper lower abs. It's incredibly difficult, especially if it's within a circuit too. I mean, that just, it only adds to it, so.
It's funny, 10 years ago, the BOSU was everything. And then 5 years ago, there was an article called The Death of the BOSU, showing how much that fitness industry loves its shiny new objects. But actually, it's not about what comes and goes. It's about knowing how to use these tools in the right way. So the BOSU, still a massively effective thing, and we use it a lot in your Andy's awesome rock hard abs circuit training protocol. There's a few things, the supine stay hold was one of them, where we use the BOSU specifically because of the degree of difficulty. So what do we got there, Brian? Any comments?
Talking about that BOSU ball, would you advise doing Supermans on it?
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. It increases the degree of difficulty. Yeah, from the floor is a digression, from the BOSU is a progression. And if you can do it from a stability ball, take a friggin' video and send it to me. I'd love to see that.
Scott, how often do you assign a MET program for Andy?
Well, it depends on where he's at this point after 13 years. When Andy says it's time for a new program, I go into his file and look at the progression of programs we've done. What I would probably do at this point in Andy's career is if I assign him MET, I wouldn't keep him on it as long, because he's got the optimized metabolism, he's got the optimized metabolic effects. So leaving him on as long as I would other people would probably just fry his system and burn it out. So that's one of those areas where knowledge comes in handy, and you don't just have a blanket application for everybody. Oh, here, you do MET for 16 weeks. Oh, here, you do MET for 16 weeks. Yeah. No, you got to know your client and know about programming, what I call the ABLE approach, proper, progressive, professional, personalized programming. That's what it's all about. So I don't know, maybe once a year you get a MET program?
Yeah, maybe, if that, maybe.
Can't even quantify it, because I don't work in quantification.
It's not, I mean, when I do get them, they're wicked hard, that's for sure, but maybe more hybrid programs.
Yeah, he probably gets more hybrid programs now, which has a little bit of stuff, like when you would, like what we did at the beginning with the superset of the straight arm pull downs with the swimmers, he gets a little bit of that stuff here and there. But he's already set metabolism-wise. He's already set development-wise. So we go back to the safer approaches, right? Because why ruin a Picasso, right? You don't just splash paint on a Picasso because you have paint. That's a lot of people's approach, unfortunately, to program design, is just throw it in. We don't do that, right? So he's back more on the traditional bodybuilding-type programming with a little bit of an ABLE sort of twist to
I would say for the most part,
So
how do you know if you're the right fit for a cycle diet?
Oh, well, you'd have to go into the cycle diet and the book, and it talks all about how to orient yourself to get into super compensation mode and how long it might take. I would say specifically guidance, getting the right guidance. So because a lot of people with stuff like that, they see what they want to see.
They see the cheat day.
They see the feedback they want to see, and I'm going to have a refeed day. I'm going to have a refeed meal. Well, you know, you have to be in the right metabolic position for that super compensation mode, we call it. That's all explained in the book and especially in the course, and you can find that at thecycle.diet. That's thecycle.diet, no space between the cycle and dot diet. And if you just want the book, it's thecycle.diet/book. And I think you're mentioned in there several times, right? Yeah. So it's the great thing about a diet is it's a diet strategy that works, not a diet that works. So a diet strategy that allows Andy to look like a cover model 12 months a year, rather than, you know, having to deprive himself all year long to look like this for 2 weeks, which makes no sense to me. But that's the competitor mindset. No, thank you. I would rather have something sustainable that I can anticipate and look forward to every week. What's on the agenda this Sunday? Anything decided
I'm not
yet?
Too sure. Football's over now, so I might just have maybe a Netflix day. Veg out and pig out.
Yeah, so. What's on for food?
Oh, anything? For food. I'm not too sure. I'm probably just going to wing it this week. I don't know.
Wing it, literally, or metaphorically? We already had wings. Okay. Yeah. And that's the other nice thing about the cycle diet is I even have an extra grocery day. I go for my real groceries on Wednesday, and on Saturdays I go grocery store hopping to try to think of, what am I going to have tomorrow? What am I going to enjoy for my cycle diet refeed? Or I go out for dinner with somebody and really, you know, enjoy it that way. And so, I mean, there's that element to it as well. It's really a good lifestyle that fits into
the world we live in of food abundance and incredible food.
I wouldn't want to live
culinary arts. Yeah, I wouldn't want
enjoying we food. Don't, like it's
we don't believe in living in a world of denial and deprivation. That whole mindset is just something that makes no sense to me. So yeah, and we can talk about that another time. Actually, next time I go live, I do have a printout of a client who wrote me today that talks exactly about cycle diet feedback, which I can explain, that shows how and why he's in super comp mode with his refeeds. And I'll talk about that when I come live next, maybe sometime on the weekend. So anything else there, Brian?
No, we're looking at, some people are just finding it hard to focus on what you're saying, Scott, for some reason.
Oh, is that right?
Joke.
What might that reason be? I know, it's because I'm a whole lot of pretty. Yeah, I'm 50 pounds of pretty in a 10-pound bag, folks, I know. Anyway, we're going to sign out. We're going to probably come at you every Thursday while we're shooting Andy's. It's going to be called something along the lines of Andy's Awesome Rock Hard Ab Circuits. That's sort of the tentative name we've come to, just because I've been saying it between shoots of every exercise, because I just get so animated and excited while we're doing it, because it looks pretty freaking cool. So
it is going to be cool.
It is going to be cool. Yeah. Pumped. So pretty pumped about getting that done for everybody and getting it on board. And meantime, you have questions for us, you know, you can send them to scottablefitness.com, or you can send them to me at scott@scottable.com, or you can even send questions to Andy at
realandysinclairfitness.com, or you can go to my Instagram at realandysinclair.
And then, you know, if you got a good question, we will read it when we go live. But for now, live is probably not something I can announce a whole lot. Next time I go live, I'll probably be solo. Not solo, you can't see me, but I'll be solo by myself, and I'll do that cycle diet letter email from an actual client, and sort of point out to you, you know, that question about cycle diet. We don't have the time right now for me to get into the ins and outs, but how do you know you're in super comp mode? How do you know the cycle diet's right for you? I have a client email that sort of lays that stuff out really succinctly. So look for me to be on live either Saturday sometime or Sunday sometime, probably without Andy, if you can live with that, folks. And I'll do some AMA, which means ask me anything. And we'll do those probably on the weekend. So we're signing off till next Thursday. Andy, anything to say?
No, not too much. Enjoy the rest of the week. Enjoy your weekend. And we'll see you back here next Thursday.
Booyah!
To it.
Still learning.